example, Brady's method. Continued, right? So we use the energy methods to derive the equation of motion by Rayleigh's method, and then the outcome of that basically was that for any mechanical system that you can model using the energy method, approximation by Rayleigh's method, the equivalent mass and the equivalent stiffness that is resolved, resulted from those derivations would be these. For equivalent mass, you have what? 0 to L of rho times phi squared x dx for the continuous part. For the continuous portion, if you have a distributed mass, and for the lumped masses, if you have n number of lumped masses, you have mi times evaluating that function at where the location of these masses are. In other words, if you have something like this, right, several masses located at different locations, and so on, M1, M2, M3, and so on. That is for those, for discrete masses. This is for this distributed mass. So you can find the equivalent mass that way. For the springs or the total stiffness of the system, if you have several lumped stiffnesses or springs, K1, K2, K3, and so on, that are located at different positions, and of course the beam itself has also some stiffness, the total stiffness is evaluated by this equation, right? EI, okay, times second derivative of that function squared dx plus some I is from 1 to n of ki phi squared at every location. So in order to find then the natural frequency of any physical system or modeling any physical system using Rayleigh's method, that's the end result. All you have to do to find the natural frequency, evaluating these two expressions, okay? So let's set up an example and demonstrate that. One or two problems. Let's now see how it works, for instance, for a simply supported system. This can be a rotating machinery with a lumped mass, maybe a disc sitting in the center of this rotating machinery, okay? The mass of this lumped mass, let's say it's M, and the beam itself has a distributed mass with density rho. Remember, rho is measured as per linear distance. It's not per volume. So the length of this is L, and the mass is in the middle of the beam, so I'm going to take advantage of the symmetry and set up the coordinate system here. As you can see, it makes the life easier, because that way, since this is symmetric, instead of taking the integral from 0 to L, I consider that 0 to L over 2 and just multiply that by 2. The key is, as we have seen in using Rayleigh's method, comes down to finding or choosing this phi of x. So for a candidate, and as we said, this shape function is what basically we find from the analogy or the comparison between the static deflected shape and the dynamic one. Since the qualitative shape of the static deformation is similar to the first fundamental mode of the vibration, we use that as the shape function. So we saw that, for instance, for a cantilever beam, this phi of x was 3/2 x over L squared minus 1/2 x over L cubed. For a simply supported beam vibrating, the vibration, the first mode of vibration, or the small oscillation, would resemble the deformation under a static load in the center of the beam. And we have seen, or you know how to hopefully even derive, okay, the shape or the displacement of this beam, which is given by this equation, 6Lx squared plus 4x cubed. I do not expect you to be able to derive this function or even remember that. That's okay, but you remember how you did it, right? You use basically what? Depending how it was introduced to you, you basically use this differential equation, the curvature of the beam. Moment of force is a function of x, so you have a second order differential equation. You have some initial conditions, the boundary conditions for the beam. For instance, here displacement is zero. Here the rotation is zero, so which is a y prime. So having those boundary conditions, you can solve and get this equation. I don't expect you to be able to derive that or remember that. These are tabulated for basic, structure elements. Yes?
So we don't have to derive
them. You don't have to derive them. They're either given to you or they're tabulated and so on. But the key is that we need these in order to identify, if you're using the Rayleigh's method, a function that can describe the qualitative deformation shape of this structure. So this is, in this case, this is phi of x that I'm going to use for that problem. So based on that then, let's just find equivalent mass and equivalent the stiffness. As I said, I will consider half of this because of the symmetry. We have 2 times 0, L over 2. The first equation for M equivalent, right? You need to basically rho is a constant value. You need to square this, right? And then take the integral of that. So this would be L cubed minus 6 L x squared plus 4 x cubed squared dx. Then you have a lumped mass in the center of the beam. But since we move the coordinate system to the center, and x is measured from the origin, so the location of this mass, which is ai, would be at x equal to 0. So if x is equal to 0 here, as you can see, you only have, for the second part, m times phi evaluated at equal to x equal to 0 is squared. So this is 0, this is 0, so we only have this term, so it would be basically L cubed to the power of 2. That's what M phi squared would be, right? So let's expand this and simplify that and evaluate it. If you do that, you get 2 times L6x plus 36 over 5 L squared x5 plus 16/7 x 7 − 4 L4 x³ + 2 L³ x² − 8 L x6 from 0 to L over 2 plus M L 6. Okay, so simplify this and you will get 0.4857 rho L to the 7 plus M L 6. This is the mass equivalent of the system. Yes?
Can you explain that L cubed term one more time?
Here, see, phi of x, maybe I should have written that down. Phi of x is L cubed minus 6 L x squared plus 4 x cubed. This term, right, for the concentrated mass is evaluated at where the mass is located, right? Since I'm measuring the x from the origin that I have put it here in the middle, in other words, this is x, mass is located at x equal to 0.
Okay.
So this is 0 and this is 0. Any other questions? Yes.
Where is rho in the expanded line?
Here.
Below the integral?
Rho is here.
Okay.
Right, or supposed to be here. Thank you. Any other questions? Okay. So k equivalence is easier because you don't have any lumped springs. You only have the beam. So you have just 2 times the integral from 0, L over 2, times EI, second derivative of x, right, dx, of course, the square. So if you take the second derivative and square that, what you will get would be 2 EI, and EI is constant, so you take it out of the integral, 0 to L over 2 times negative 12 L plus 24 X squared dx. If you evaluate this, you get and substitute for X as L over 2, you get 48 EI L cubed. So this is the equivalence thickness. Therefore, you can easily find the natural frequency, right? The natural frequency then, if you don't mind, I'm just going to erase this part to give me some room here. The natural frequency is K equivalent over M equivalent, so would be 48 EI L cubed divided by 0.4857 rho L to the 7 plus M L 6. You can further simplify that because L 3, and you can do some simplification, 48 EI, okay, divided by 0.4857 rho L to the 4 plus M L 3. So I'm going to consider two cases. Let's say case one. I want to compare this and see how accurate it is compared to the exact natural frequency of the system. Case one, let's assume you just had a beam with no lumped mass or no disk. That is, the concentrated mass is 0. So this cancels out. So natural frequency that would result would be 48 EI over 0.4857 rho, okay, And that would be over, this comes out one over L two. So in other words, you would get one over L squared times 48 EI over 0.4857 rho. You can further simplify this and you get you'll get 9.941 EI over rho. Okay. There is a book by Blevins. He did this through a lot of hardships. Formulas for Natural Frequencies and Mode Shapes. He did this as part of his PhD work he did decades ago. In that book, by using the continuous systems vibration. See, what we are talking about here in the entire course, even the next course, is the single or multi-degree of freedom systems is based on the assumption that we can replace a physical system by a series of lumped masses. In other words, break down the entire mass of the structure in a set of lumped masses and including the stiffness and basically study the vibratory motion of a system. In reality, there is no such a thing as lumped masses. Systems, masses is distributed through the system, through the beam or whatnot. So that is a different class of vibration, which is continuous system. And instead of using ordinary linear differential equations, you need to use partial differential equations. But by using that, you can actually derive the exact natural frequency or mode shape of a system. So that's what Blevins did. And he did it for a large number of structural elements, say a simply supported beam, beams with fixed and support, you know, cantilever beam, all kinds of support, all kinds of boundary conditions. And if you look at those tables, all of these are tabulated. So if you go to Blevins, you see the exact value for the natural frequency of a simply supported beam, which we have here, is given as 9.869 EI over rho L to the 4. So the difference between these is about 0.7% error. Case two, if you consider that lumped mass, and for all practical purposes, let's say that lumped mass is twice the entire mass of the beam, or three times the entire mass of the beam, which is a very reasonable assumption. For instance, if you have a rotating machinery, think of a wing of an aircraft with two engines. The weight or the mass of each of those is far heavier than the beam itself that is holding it. So let's say if you consider that mass being three times the mass of the beam, okay? So you need to consider that in here. If you do that, you will get basically, in this case, you get three times L to the rho times L7. So in other words, M equivalent becomes, in this case, 0.4857 rho to the L7 plus 3 rho L to the 7. So if you substitute that there, natural frequency that you would be calculating becomes 3.711 square root of EI over rho L to the 4. If you go to Blevins' tables, you see that the exact natural frequency for this case would be 3.7086, that square root. So the difference is about error is about 0.061%. You remember I promised you that, or at least I claimed that Mr. Rayleigh did a great job by introducing this approach, because you can estimate the natural frequency of a complex system with a very high level of accuracy. It all, of course, depends on how good you do a job with modeling a system. But if you do that, as you can see, you can find it. If you have a rotating machinery, you don't have to do a complex finite element as your first approximation. You go to a company, let's say Solar Turbine hires you as a graduate of Cal Poly, and they expect you to hit the ground running right the first day because you're a Cal Poly graduate. Then they tell you, oh, you know what? We have this system that we have designed. You know what Solar Turbine makes? Power generation system, right? So they're turbines, turbo machinery, right? And they tell you, you are a good Cal Poly grad. So maybe in your interview, if I give you one of these systems, tell me if I mount it on a beam, maybe with this characteristics, whatever, would that be safe or not? So what you have to do, find the natural frequency of that. And they tell you, okay, what do you do to find natural frequency? You would never say that I'm going to use ANSYS to do a finite element model and complex this and that. Say, you know, we learned in mechanical vibration there was a guy named Rayleigh, right? And you go and study a little bit about Rayleigh and who he was. And he introduced this powerful method, so you can do that job in 10 minutes and you're offered a good job with a good salary, right? So that's how it works. But anyway, that I promise you, and as you can see, what I claimed was true. So what do you do now for your project? I think that's what you're anxious to know. So that's what I want you to do for your project, right? So the project had three parts. You are supposed to use Rayleigh's method, right? You do exact, I'll show you, of course, for the specific case. And then what else? Experimentally. The experimental part is just, the sky is the limit. You have all kinds of options. You can do it a very complex way, you can do it a very simple way. My suggestions are, obviously, as an engineer, choose the easiest path, right? But there are a couple of, you know, basic words of caution. Consider a thin beam that basically when you vibrate it, free vibration lasts for a few, at least, good time. Let's say you choose a cantilever beam. This can be an example, right? Consider, as I've stated in the statement, consider a thin beam. Make sure that is a beam, is not a plate. The aspect ratio is very important. In other words, if you consider a square piece of metal and you basically clamp this to a, you know, place to make sure it's fixed at this edge, and you vibrate this, the square thin plate, this is 10 inch, this is 10 inch, this is not a beam. This is a plate. So the vibration, natural frequency, those characteristics are quite different than a beam. So consider a long, slender piece, aluminum, steel. The criteria was what? You should not spend more than $5. So if it's a five-member team, no more than $1 per person. And you have to document that. Convince me that you spend no more than $5. Do not include your labor. That's free. Okay? Or at least consider as free. Okay? So you choose something like this, for instance. This is 1/4 inch. this is 1 inch. Okay, and this is, let's say, 27 inches and 1/8 of an inch, okay? So let's say I want to find the natural frequency of something like this with these properties. It's a steel, so the mass density is about 0.283 pound per inch cube. The modulus of elasticity is 30 times 10 to the 6 psi, and the second moment of the area, okay, still I cannot believe that we use the same notation that we use for the second moment of area and the mass moment of inertia. And in static, you don't have such a thing as mass or inertia. So this is, although we call that moment of inertia, it is actually second moment of this area. Remember that. So you have an area of 1 inch, I'm sorry, 1/4 inch, 1 inch, bending about this centroidal axis. So if this is B, this is H, this would be 1/12 BH. Cube, and I'm sure you remember that, right? So that's that. So you want to find the natural frequency of this using Rayleigh's method, and so on. First, as far as the exact is concerned, the exact value, you go to the table, or if you do not find it, this is what you will find. Okay? EI, that's how these are tabulated. Where M bar is mass density per length. Okay? So let's find the exact natural frequency of a piece like this, which is what you should do for your own case. So this would be what? Would be 3.516 divided by 27.1875 squared, the square root of 30 times 10 to the 6 psi times 1/12 times B times 0.25 cubed. So this is I, this is E, divided by, you need to convert this to mass per length, so you need to multiply 0.283 times the area, which is 1 times 0.25, okay? Now you need to convert that to pound mass, 386, the famous slug, right? So if you do that, you get 69.4418 radians per second. Or if you convert this to hertz, which is divide that basically by 2 pi, the frequency is 111.05 hertz. So this is the exact natural frequency of a piece like that. That's something you need to do for your own system. If you use Rayleigh's method, you don't have a lumped mass, you just have a continuous mass. You don't have a lumped spring. So formula would be very easy, right? Your mass equivalent would be just simply 0 to L of rho times phi squared dx, where phi is what? You use this shape function, right? So that's for your mass. If you substitute, you can substitute there, and I will just give you the answer. Okay, you get rho is this. Don't forget. So if you substitute for that, you will get, or in other words, let me make sure you do realize that rho is 0.283 times 0.25 times 12 divided by 386. So if you do that, you get 12.326 slug. Okay, and then for K equivalent, you get just 0 to L of EI phi double, and the second derivative of phi squared dx. There is no lump spring. If you substitute for E and I, what you get is 583.141. Okay? And natural frequency then would be K equivalent over mass equivalent, comes out to be 68.78 radians per second, or 10.947 hertz, about 0.95% error. So if you do this for your own system, and you will be amazed to see how the exact solution, Rayleigh's method, how close they are, 2-3% error at most. For the approximation, few things that you need to be careful. One I mentioned, as far as the aspect ratio, make sure you have a thin beam. Probably the easiest way to measure the frequency is what? Have a long, slender, thin beam. How do you do that? Just take your phone. I'm sure you have a stopwatch here, right? Turn it on. Deform it. Let it vibrate. So it's what? Cycles per second, right? So you find it in hertz. That's the easiest. Or you can do something more fancier, you know? Let's make it nicer. Go to the lab and do all kinds of other things. So, but anyway, because what you have is what? You have a sinusoidal motion, right? You're measuring between the two amplitudes, right? That's one cycle. That's a natural frequency for a free vibration. But anyway, if you're using a fixed end, you're clamping it somewhere, make sure this table is quite solid. You do not feel the slightest motion, because then what you're measuring is not accurate. So, simple. And you have 1 week. In fact, to give you the 1 week, you know what was the main objective? Otherwise, you could have done it in 2 days. What do you think? Any intelligent guess? That you can develop some camaraderie and new friendships. You haven't met your teams yet. So give you 1 week to do that, right? Okay, so that's, yes.
So are the, like that equation up there, the one from the books?
Yeah, this one, the exact, yeah. Right. That's what a cantilever beam.
That's like a measured value? Or
this is the exact value.
How did they determine it?
As I said, Dr. Blevins did that for you.
Okay.
So he's tabulated.
Like a different method?
What, using continuous vibration method, in other words, you can derive the exact solution. So it's tabulated, you can find it online. You don't have to go and buy his book anymore. I'm sure you can find it, just Google it. Exact solution for the natural frequency of a cantilever beam, or simply supported beam, or fixed beam, whatever, right? So you find it. Any other questions? So where are we? We are going to summarize, right? It's always good to know where we are before we go somewhere, right? You remember the famous, you know, the famous Yogi Berra? Right? He has a famous quote. If you don't know where you're going, you will never get there. I mean, that guy was actually quite intelligent, but he was a very decent, simple-minded guy who could not express himself very eloquently, But he said all kinds of wonderful things in a very layman terms, right? Another famous one he had is this. Make sure you go to your friends' funerals, otherwise they won't come to yours. Have you heard that one? They're dead, so of course they cannot come to yours, right? So, but anyway, yeah, Yogi Berra. So, with that said, in his honor, let's summarize where we are. So where are we? We started by introducing what mechanical vibration is all about. The objective is to what? Is to understand the nature of the vibratory system. Either because you want to either isolate the unwanted vibration or take advantage of the vibration, right? So in order to do that, we introduce basically a few key concepts. Degrees of freedom. We said that we do model a system basically being consisting of a bunch of lumped masses distributed, you know, over the entire structure. Each mass moves and defines a degree of freedom. But if there is a dominant degree of freedom, in other words, one of these masses dominates the motion, which is always the case for the first sort of small amplitude vibration, which resembles the static deformation, we consider the system can basically be represented by the motion of that dominant mass or a single degree of freedom. Or a degree of freedom, we call that a single degree of freedom. So then we spend then, okay, some time understanding what is a single degree of freedom, model that, and you know, we spent 3 weeks, as I promised, to see that we can actually model even very complex physical system by this simple looking innocent system, which we call that equivalent, you know, single degree of freedom system, as long as we can find equivalent stiffness and equivalent mass. And we use three methods. For simple systems, use the structural analysis, and then energy methods. And the highlight of energy methods, which was the most powerful approach, was Rayleigh's method, which by using that we demonstrated that basically any complex system can be represented by a single degree of freedom system, meaning that we can find the equivalent stiffness, equivalent mass, and find the natural frequency, which is one of the most important inherent dynamic characteristics of a vibratory system, natural frequency, right? So that was the first part of the course. So 25%, almost. So we have 75% left. What are we gonna do? Remember, I said mechanical vibration is classified or categorized. We don't have classification because you don't have anything classified in this course. Everything is unclassified, okay? So either we differentiate various cases in mechanical vibration based on the fact that either system is vibrating freely or under the action of a force that is acting on the system. So we call that free vibration and forced vibration. And in each case, we look at whether the system is undamped or damped. So undamped, undamped. So basically four cases. We studied the first one. In fact, this is what we studied that led to defining the natural frequency understanding the modeling, because we said that vast majority of mechanical structure systems can be assumed to be undamped, which is a good, is a reasonable assumption. We studied that, we derived the equation of motion. In other words, we solved this differential equation, which represents the system. It was, the solution was a harmonic function. This is the amplitude, we call this the phase angle. And this is the frequency of the that harmonic vibration, which was the natural frequency of the oscillation. And we looked at, of course, some important interpretation of that response, right? For instance, how to represent this in terms of initial conditions. So now, the next step is we're going to look at free vibration of damped system. So all we need to do, or all we have here now, we still have that single degree of freedom system, okay? In this single degree of freedom system, as we have now learned, by now we are convinced, these two that are the inherent characteristics of a system, mass and the stiffness, can be identified, can be modeled, can be basically derived as a single component, right? What is added here now is this element, which we call that a damper, that represents now the energy absorption or dissipation characteristic of the system. We haven't, we will not discuss anything how to model this, so we just make the assumption that this is a force, and this force is a constant that we call the damping coefficient of the system times the velocity of the system. So in contrast to these two that could be derived based on the physical characteristics of a system, you do not derive these, you make an assumption. It's a pure assumption. In other words, this is not necessarily what a system does in terms of how it dissipates energy. But based on that assumption then, so by drawing a free body diagram of this vibratory system, okay, that we know what this is, and what this is, the equation of motion would be of this form. And this is what we are going to do now. We are going to solve this problem, interpret that, understand that. This simple, nice, innocent looking equation, however, in contrast to that one, is open to interpretation, or in other words, it depends on basically a key element, which is the damping. In order to solve this, as you know, you do set up the characteristic function. You find the roots, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and the solution, right, is what? A1 e to the lambda 1 plus A2 e to the lambda 2. However, as you can see, lambda 1 and lambda 2, right, would be what? You have 1 over 2m, or rather the solution for this differential equation would be what? You have 1 over 2m, okay? Uh, minus c plus and minus c squared minus 4km. So I'm going to stop right here, but at least give you a heads up. As you can see, we don't have a unique solution anymore. The solution, depending on what the sign of this is, in other words, if it's this is negative, zero, or positive, you have three, you know, distinct cases that we're going to discuss, study, and derive. So with that said,